Good morning, friends. Today we have a session on issues in capital gain. And we have our speaker today with us is CA Pankaj G. Shah. Sir is a senior chartered accountant and qualified company secretary. Sir is a bachelor in law qualification, also in bachelor in business administration. Sir has also completed DISA from our Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Sir is also pursuing PhD in taxation. Sir was the chairman of Indore branch ICAI for the year 2019-20. Sir is on advisory board of Commerce Faculty of Devi Ahilya University, Indore. Sir was chairman of International Taxation Committee of Central Region of ICAI. Sir is board member of Tax Bar. Sir is a prolific author on taxation and a national speaker in seminars and conferences. Sir is regularly representing before ITAT, BIFR, Settlement Commission and other authorities. Sir's opinion and article are published in various leading daily newspaper also. With this brief introduction, would like to hand over charge of the session to CA Pankaj sir. Sir, please continue, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Virag. I would like to welcome all the participants in this knowledge enhancing session on critical issues in capital gains under the Income Tax Act. What is taxable under Income Tax Act? As we all know, it is the element of income which is taxable under Income Tax Act. And prima facie, capital gains was not an income. In 1922 Act, when the department tried to tax a capital gain as income, far back in the case of Navneet Lal C. Jhaveri, it was held that capital gains is a kind of capital receipt and it is not an income. It was only thereafter that the Act was amended and Section 224, which defines income, included capital gains, which is deemed as income. So at the first count, capital gains is a deeming fiction. It is deemed as income and it is not per se as income. So when it is deemed as income, a deeming fiction has a limited application. So unless all the criteria, conditions of the charging section of capital gains is satisfied, any other capital received is not an income and therefore cannot be taxed. So what can be taxed under Section 45, which is the charging section of capital gains? At the outset, there are four main conditions which will be the basis of our discussion. First amongst it is that the asset should be a capital asset. Unless there is a capital asset, there cannot be any capital gain. What is a capital asset? Capital asset is an inclusive term. It would include asset of any kind, whether it is tangible or intangible, any kind of right. It is a very wide term and would include almost every kind of tangible and intangible asset or any kind of right. But then it has certain exceptions. Like it does not include a rural agricultural land, it does not include certain type of bonds, it does not include some personal effects, for example silver utensils. So these are negative definitions which are excluded from capital asset definition. Otherwise everything can be regarded as a capital asset. But what to do with that capital asset? That capital asset may be held for long and long. Unless that capital asset is transferred. When it is transferred? It is transferred in the previous year. Then the resultant gain or loss can be taxable in the previous year in which such capital asset is transferred. But then there is another condition. The gain or loss from the transfer of capital asset will not be taxable if such gain or loss is either exempt under section 10 or a deduction has been claimed under section 54 to 54 GA of the Act. So these are the basic tenets based on which the chargeability of capital gain would be decided. We have to remember all these things. After this chargeability is there, if we see the third main important part, gain or loss arising of the transfer. How will you compute the gain or loss? What is gain or loss? Gain means all the receipts less all the costs or expenditure. Receipt is basically the sale consideration. In the old decision of Sunil Siddharth Bhai, Supreme Court had held that unless the sale consideration is determinable, you can precisely value or you can precisely fix what is the sale consideration, then only capital gain could be computed, because gain could not be computed unless there is a upper numerator which is the sale consideration. So Supreme Court held that unless sale consideration is determinable, the capital gain mechanism will fail. Overruling this, there is an amendment, section 50D is inserted, where the sale consideration cannot be determined, you can value the fair market value, and that fair market value will be assigned as the sale consideration. On the other hand, cost of acquisition, which is to be reduced from sale consideration, that should also be determinable. Unless that cost of acquisition is determinable, if the cost of acquisition cannot be determined, Supreme Court in the case of B.C. Srinivasa Shetty has held that the capital gain mechanism will fail and you cannot calculate the gain or loss, and therefore the chargeability, capital gain mechanism, everything will be failed and there will be no tax on whatever will be your income or whatever is your receipt from such capital gains. So we need to have a capital asset, we need to have transfer, we should have a gain or loss for which a sale consideration and cost of acquisition both are important, and lastly it should not be, the gain or loss should not be exempt or should not be deductible from under section 54 to 54 G. These are the basic conditions on which our total discussion of today would revolve around. What we have done, capital gain is like an ocean, and we have taken out the pearls, all those issues which may provide good opportunity for our members to plan the affairs of our client, or how we can mitigate the impact of taxation within the four corners of law. What are the opportunities available, how and the affairs can be legally planned so that we can give the result of minimum taxation, minimum tax incidence under capital gain can be levied. Now moving ahead to sale consideration. As we all know, sale consideration has to be actual sale consideration. Sale consideration prima facie could not be deemed. As we all know, sale consideration in the case of KP Vergis, it is held, Supreme Court in the case of KP Vergis had held that you cannot assume some sale consideration, it has to be the actual sale consideration. Department cannot allege that, okay, you have received so much, but you should have received much more than this, unless they have some clinching evidence that the actual price which you have received is more. So following the KP Vergis decision, which lays down the sale consideration, it has to be actual. Then there was an amendment, section 50C was inserted, which deems the stamp duty value or the actual receipt as the, whichever is higher, as the sale consideration. So 50C deems sale consideration only in case of land or building. If there is any other asset, 50C will not apply, because 50C is only applicable on land or building. It even does not apply to rights in that land or building. For example, there are tenancy rights. For example, there are leasehold rights. Section 50C does not apply to the rights in land or building. It only applies to the land and building. Now we all know that valuation is neither an art nor a science. So the stamp duty authorities may value the sale consideration or the guideline value or the circle rate to be at X amount, but value cannot be, or the price can never be determined on the guideline value. So since it is not a perfect science, and there have been cases where the guideline was either too high or maybe too low, they have given us an option. Now the act has been amended, and as recently there the tolerance band which is incorporated in the act. What is this tolerance band? If the guideline value is at X amount, or rather the actual consideration, I have done a deal for a land for rupees 1 crore, so I'll get an tolerance band of 10%. For example, the guideline value is 1 crore 7 lakhs or 1 crore 9 lakhs, then my actual consideration will be deemed as sale consideration, and the excess of 7 lakh, which is within the tolerance band of 10%, will be ignored. But one point to be remembered, as the amount exceeds even 1 rupee more than this 10%, I'll not get benefit of a single penny. For example, my actual consideration is 1 crore and my stamp duty value for that land is 1 crore 10 lakh 50 rupees. Because this 50 rupees is more than the 10%, I'll not get any benefit of this 10%, and my tax, my sale consideration would be deemed as 1 crore 10 lakh 50 rupees. So we need to keep in mind that this 10%, if is exceeded, then we will not get any benefit. One more important thing, this 10% has to be considered of actual consideration. If you wrongly take it of the sale consideration or stamp duty value, then there will be issues. Because if we plan, I'll take an example, the stamp duty value is 1 crore. So I'll say, okay, stamp duty value is 1 crore, so I'll do the deal in 90 lakh 10,000. Then I'm sorry that you will not get benefit of this tolerance band, because what will be done is they'll go reverse and then calculate 10% of that 90 lakh 10,000, which will come there as 99 lakh or something. So in those case, you will not get benefit of this tolerance band. Another important thing, this tolerance band was though inserted as recently 2 years back, and this year the limit from 5% has been increased to 10%. Since it is a curative amendment, it will be given a retrospective effect. In my presentation, you can see there are two decisions. One is of Kolkata Tribunal and another is of Delhi Tribunal. Delhi Tribunal is as recently as 19 February 2020 has held that this amendment of tolerance band in the 50C will be given a retrospective. So if there are some old pending cases pending, you will get the benefit. You can claim the benefit of the tolerance band of 10%, which is now incorporated in the act for the purposes of claiming the actual consideration apart from stamp duty value. Moving ahead, there is a concept that if there are 2-3 persons, they want to enter into partnership, they can bring any immovable property or any property into the firm. Section 45(3) says, if you contribute any property to the firm, the property will be recorded at certain value in the books of accounts of the partnership firm. The value at which it is recorded in the books of partnership firm shall be deemed to be the sale consideration. I'll give an example. I have a land which is worth rupees 10 crores as per the stamp duty circle rate, but I want to, my cost was say 2 crore rupees and the index cost would be 5 crores and I do not have liquidity right now. So I want to introduce it at 5 crore rupees in the firm. So the firm records it at the value of rupees 5 crore in its books of account. So as per section 45(3), the sale consideration would be 5 crore. A question arises here that what would prevail, section 50C or section 45(3) of that. 45(3) is a specific provision as compared to 50C, which is a general provision applying in all cases. So an argument may be taken that 45(3) would prevail over the section 50C provision, and the sale consideration recorded in books of accounts would be the actual sale consideration and stamp duty value should not be taken. This view is supported by Bombay Tribunal decision in case of Amar Tara Private Limited, 2018 TIL 125. This can be referred. In various stamp duty acts also, it provides that when you contribute some property into the firm, you will get a concessional stamp duty applicable on it. In some states, it is around 2 to 3%, which is much less than 8 to 9% in case of normal transfer. So this is also an important aspect. You can plan your affairs by contributing your property into your partnership firm. Moving ahead, when you plan your affairs through a partnership firm, what happens when you retire from that firm? There is an old decision of Supreme Court in case of Mohan Bhai Pama Bhai. That decision says, if your capital account in the firm has a balance of 15 lakh rupees and originally you had inserted or you had your capital, your original capital contribution was 1 lakh rupees, and now you are coming out with 15 lakhs, which is your capital balance. What you are getting is the balance which stood to your account in the partnership firm, and therefore you are not getting anything excess. In such case, there will be no capital gain liability. But if your capital balance stands at 15 lakh rupees and you are getting 20 lakh, 25 lakh from the firm, in those cases, there will be a capital gain liability. Because what you are getting is more than what was your share in the firm. In those cases, there will be a capital gain. There are various decisions which deal with this kind of concepts. First thing you need to remember, if you accept or withdraw your cash element from the firm, you will not be subjected to tax if you withdraw what is yours and you are withdrawing it in cash. But if you take any asset from the firm, section 45(4) is there, which says that the fair market value of that asset will be considered as sale consideration and firm will be taxed on that transfer of asset. For example, if you had contributed a car and now you are withdrawing that car, or if you are taking a land, or if you are taking a building from that firm as your retirement share, in those cases, there will be capital gain. But if you only withdraw your cash element from the firm, then there will be no tax. Many times what is being done is, I had contributed a land for say rupees 5 lakhs. Now new partners are intending to come and acquire over the firm. What you may do is revalue the land. Today's value of land is say rupees 25 lakh rupees. You had brought it in 5 lakh rupees. Then you may revalue the land at 25 lakhs and credit the partner's capital accounts accordingly. And then you may withdraw that sum which is standing to your capital account, and new partners may come, they may join and they may continue the firm. Then there is a possibility that there may not be any capital gain incident as per the decision of Karnataka High Court in the case of Dynamic Enterprises. It is a full bench decision of Karnataka High Court. So this kind of plannings are also being done in case of capital gain. Then this planning is approved by the decision of Karnataka High Court full bench, which says that the law of partnership as per the act and considered in the case of Mohan Bhai Pama Bhai Supreme Court, further in the case of Dynamic Enterprises, have provided this option to the taxability of partnership firms. So this is an interesting aspect, and this loophole has not yet been plugged in the parliament. Maybe the parliament or the legislative wants that they should not change and they should keep the taxation of partnership as simple, and therefore this still stands. Moving ahead, we had discussed that the cost of acquisition must be determinable, and there should be a capital asset which is being transferred. I have a running business, which is an undertaking. I want to transfer that undertaking. What would be the cost of acquisition of that undertaking? What do you mean by undertaking? It is a running business. What does the running business have? It has assets and liabilities. What kind of assets? It may have fixed assets. It may have current assets. But then it may also have certain intangible assets, like my trade relations with the client, my trade behavior, which has been appreciated. My employees are satisfied, job satisfied, so they are giving good performance. All these aspects are also very important, and you cannot attribute cost to these aspects. So long back, in case of PNB Finance, it was held by Supreme Court that in case of an undertaking, the cost of acquisition cannot be determined of an undertaking. It is not mere the cost of assets, and therefore capital gain mechanism failed. To overrule this, an amendment was brought by section 50B. This 50B deals with slump sale. Whenever you transfer an undertaking by way of a sale, what would happen is that net worth of that undertaking will be deemed as its cost of acquisition. Now, the cost of acquisition becomes the net worth. What would happen when the cost of acquisition is negative, net worth is negative? Earlier, Zuari Industries had held that the net worth may be negative in case of a loss-making enterprise. So you ignore the losses and take the cost of acquisition as zero. But then it was overruled by special bench of tribunal in case of Sumit Securities, which now says that even negative, you have to consider it. I'll give an example. I have losses of 50 lakhs, so my net worth is minus 50 lakhs. I'm selling my undertaking for 1 crore 50 lakh rupees. So my capital gains will be 1 crore 50 lakhs minus 50 lakhs. So minus plus. So my capital gains will become 2 crore rupees. So negative net worth also has to be considered. Then your undertaking may have certain land or building. So while valuing sale consideration of that undertaking, whether 50C will be applied? No. Same Sumit Securities has held that if there is a transfer of undertaking, it is not land or building per se, and therefore 50C will not apply. Undertaking has to be taken as a specific capital asset, and you cannot dissect it to have land separate, building separate in the undertaking. You have to value the whole undertaking as a whole. So in such cases, 50C will not apply. Then there are some other issues. Section 48 also gives you option to deduct certain expenses. Which expenses? Which are directly attributable to transfer of that asset. You have a property which has some wrongful possession of a tenant, he is not vacating, and you are making some payment to the tenant for vacation of that premises. If you do not get it vacated, you cannot transfer it. Nobody will buy it. So therefore, this may be regarded as expenditure incurred directly in connection with transfer. And Delhi High Court in case of Eagle Theatres has held that you will get a deduction of this expenditure. What happens in the hands of that tenant? There are various decisions which say that an amount received against a wrongful possession is called mesne profits. It is pronounced as main profits, M-E-S-N-E. Such main profits are also regarded as capital receipts in various cases. You may refer special bench decision in case of five-member bench was there in case of Narang Commercial, where it is held that main profits are not taxed. Then there is a decision of Balbir Singh Maini Supreme Court, which has changed the capital gain scenario totally. If you see Balbir Singh Maini, this is interpretation of section 247, which defines transfer. Long back, the scenario was unless the conveyance through which the transfer is happening is not registered, the transfer could not happen. Merely by giving possession, transfer could not happen. But then Registration Act was amended, and it said that even though there may not be any registration, you go to section 53 of Transfer of Property Act, and if there is part performance of contracts and possession is given, it will be deemed as transfer. Same was incorporated in Income Tax Act, and even if you do not give a possession, even if you do not get the document registered, the same will be considered as transfer best example Chaturbhuj Dwarkadas Bombay High Court itself in case of joint development agreement. If the joint development agreement is executed, it may or may not have been signed. The date of signing of agreement was considered as transfer. Later on, because of this decision of Balbir Singh Maini, the same is overruled. Now a registered agreement is must. So even if you give up possession of a property, it may not be a transfer after the decision of Balbir Singh Maini unless the agreement is registered. But here I would like to caution you, such kind of transactions where there is possession is given but the same is not registered in the hands of possessor, as per the new Benami Transaction Prohibition Act amended in 2016-17, now all such kind of property may be regarded as Benami property. You may have to incur penalties of such Benami law and the property may be confiscated by the government. So this Balbir Singh Maini read with the Benami Transaction Prohibition Act may have serious implications which we must understand. So a combined reading now says that even if the possession is given but the agreement is not registered, it may not be regarded as transfer. Moving ahead, there are also certain fundamental principles of Registration Act. Section 47 says you may have entered into an agreement, the agreement is executed but it is not yet registered by the registrar. When the same is registered, it would relate back to the date of execution of that agreement. I'll give you an example. I have executed an agreement on 30th March and the registrar registers it on 5th April. The registration done on 5th April will relate back and will be considered with effect from 30th March itself. So Section 47 of the Registration Act says that the registration would relate back to the date of execution of agreement. I have also cited certain other decisions which may help you in propounding good arguments before the tribunals and appellate authorities wherever the related cases may come. Another important thing is period of holding is important to determine whether the transfer is long term or short term. What should be the date of acquisition? Allotment date, possession date or registration date? There are various decisions in board circular which say that the registration or like we studied Section 47 of Registration Act, all these things, when there is an allotment that is considered as an agreement or contract and the possession may be given later, registration may be done later, but it would relate back to the date of allotment and accordingly date of allotment may be taken for calculation of the actual holding period. There are various decisions also on this principle and board circular which you may see in this presentation. Then cost of acquisition can also be increased with the interest if the property is purchased against a loan. I have acquired a property against a loan. So in case of K. Raja Gopala Rao, it is held. Then there are other decisions also of Madras Chennai Tribunal which hold that you can add the cost of acquisition, interest component to the cost of acquisition. Here, an interesting conundrum happens when you can increase the cost of acquisition on one hand and claim the deduction of interest also under 24 in house property against the rental income. But since there is no prohibition and there are various decisions supporting this stand, the deduction can be claimed at both places. This may be considered that this is still allowed to give impetus to the real estate sector and government has not brought any amendment to remove this. Now moving ahead, what would be the indexation in case of gifted or inherited property under Section 49(1) of the Act? If you read the Act, for example, I'll take an example. I have acquired a property. I have taken a property through will from my uncle who originally acquired the property in 2001 and built the property, or I inherited it in 2010. So my cost of acquisition will be his cost of acquisition in 2001. But if you plainly read the act, I'll get indexation from the year in which the asset was first held by me. So I held it in 2010 in which I inherited it. So whether I'll get indexation from 2001 or 2010, the X is 2010, but then this is considered as an anomaly or absurdity. And Bombay High Court, in case of Manjula Shah and other decisions, have held that I'll get the benefit of indexation from 2001 itself, because I am getting the cost of 2001. My indexation will also start from 2001. Then one interesting thing is a family settlement. There may be dispute between family members, and what may happen in earlier days, parents may buy property in name of different children. I am living in house X, which is owned by my brother, and my brother is living in house Y, which is registered in my name. And now we want to avoid the dispute. So we are entering into a family settlement in which we will exchange the houses. Exchange is also a transfer. We may also, for example, the value of my house in which I am staying is much, much more the value which is of other house which is registered in my brother's name, may be lesser. So there may be a family settlement deed according to which such transfer and exchange of some consideration may happen. Such case would not be considered as transfer because no new right is being created. This is merely realignment of existing rights. It is not considered as transfer. There are certain authorities which I have mentioned here. Also, though family settlement, when there is a dispute, may not be considered as transfer, but a family settlement done through corporate companies would be considered as transfer. Why? Because individual can have a family, company cannot have a family. There is a corporate wheel in between. And if you see the decision of Bombay High Court, Mohata Textiles, it has held that family settlement cannot be done through corporate entities if a company is holding a property, and if there's some exchange or some kind of realignment between companies or individuals, that would constitute a transfer if it is done through a company. But if it is done through individuals under a family settlement deed, it may not be regarded as a transfer, and therefore no capital gain may arise in such cases. There is also an interesting issue, as we discussed, that in case of undertaking, section 50B is there, which says that in case of slum sale, the cost of acquisition is net worth. But what happens when there is a slump exchange? First of all, what is the difference between sale and exchange? When you assign a monetary price to certain asset, then it will be regarded as a sale. But if you do not assign, we have two undertakings. I am giving my running business to you and taking your business because I feel that I may run your business more efficiently, and I am not able to run my business, which you may able to run efficiently, then we may exchange those businesses without deciding or assigning any prices. Those transactions may be regarded as a slump exchange because what is being exchanged are undertakings. In case of slump exchange, what is the cost of acquisition? You may say net worth. No, net worth is deeming fiction under section 50B. 50B only for the purpose of slump sale deem the cost of acquisition of net undertaking in case of sale to be the net worth. It does not do so in the case of exchange or other cases. So you may get the benefit that such kind of slump exchange may not be taxable because cost of acquisition is not determinable. This theory has been decided in favor by Bombay High Court in case of Bharat Bijli. However, we must also remember that this is an aggressive planning, and there is a against decision of Delhi High Court on this issue, SREI Infrastructure Finance Limited, which considers these transactions also as transfer and brings them under the net of tax. Moving ahead, we'll discuss some important concepts under 54 to 54F of the Act. because these are very common, and our client day and other comes to us for consulting on these issues. What happens when we have made a transaction of transfer and now we want to buy a new property? I have just bought a plot and I have not yet started the construction within the period of 3 years. Definitely, I will not be entitled to the deduction under Section 54 or 54F of the Act. But what would happen if I have purchased or I am getting a property constructed through a builder and I have given him the whole consideration, but because of the fault of builder, the construction could not be complete? In such cases, it is not my fault. And very important thing is that Section 54 to 54 GA give focus on investment reinvestment. So once I have made whole reinvestment in the property, and merely because of the fault of some other person, which is the builder, I am not able to get the possession or not get own the property within the time stipulated, I may not be made to suffer. And there is a Bombay Tribunal decision supporting this, Rajiv Bisha, which says that in such cases, I will be entitled to the deduction under Section 54 or 54F of the Act. There may also be situation where the construction is started, I have invested the whole amount, but the construction may get delayed because of some or other reason. In such cases, if my construction gets completed in 3 years, 2 months, the AO cannot deny deduction to me because I have made the total investment within the time period. And because of some or other reason, I am not able to complete the construction in such 3 years period. So a liberal view may be taken, and I may be entitled to the deduction under Section 54-54 of the Act. Moving ahead, what kind of construction is important? So it has to be a habitable house in which I can stay. It is not that I can, further there is an interesting thing. I may buy a flat and get a modular kitchen and some other basic amenities also constructed. So that will also constitute in the investment made, and I'll get deduction for that component. But if I make only two rooms and a bathroom, say, so you cannot say that that is a new residential house for me. It would depend on situation to situation. It should be a habitable house. You cannot make a garage come room and claim a deduction for a house. So it has to be a identifiable separate residential house for my permanent stay, and it should not be just for a casual stay. So there are authorities on this issue. Moving ahead, there may be situation that I'm getting a good deal, so I'll buy a old house, a 100-year old house I'm buying, and then I'm getting further construction of additional floor. So the AO may say that you have purchased the house for 50 lakh rupees and you have done additional construction of 50 lakh rupees, your capital gain is 75 lakh rupees. So I'll give you deduction only either of purchase or of construction. What would you like to have? So I'll say, sir, I have purchased a residential house and I have made further construction on it to make it habitable. So I'm claiming 50 lakhs for purchase of a residential house and on which I have constructed further 50 lakhs. So 1 crore is my total investment. AO say, I'll either allow you purchase or construction, not both. So when the law was discussed by Calcutta High Court in case of BP Sarkar, it says that if you satisfy both the conditions, there is no bar that you will not get such deduction. You may, the purpose is that you buy a habitable house, and if you get it a dilapidated house and you make some additional floors which are habitable, you will definitely be entitled to the deduction under such cases. Similarly, it may happen that you may do some extension to some your originally held house. You have one house and you make construction of a new floor. So if it is an independent residential unit, definitely you will get the benefit of 54 or 54F. But if it is just a room extra constructed, you may not get, because that may not be regarded as an independent identifiable house. Moving ahead, I buy a house, I demolish it and construct a new building. I'll be entitled to the deduction of the purchase cost as well as the construction cost in such cases, because ultimate purpose is that there should be a habitable house for residents. Then it may happen that you have three shops at different locations. This year you have sold all the three shops for 25 lakh each. You have got 75 lakh rupees from three separate houses or properties, and now you are investing whole 75 lakh in a new house under 54F. You will get a deduction for sale of multiple houses. Multiple capital gains can be invested in one new residential house, and you can claim the deduction. It may also happen that last year you had some capital gains which you have deposited in capital gain account. This year also you have capital gains. You accumulate both years capital gain and invest it in the current year. You can get the deduction of capital gain of multiple years in investment in one year in a new residential house property. That is also allowed. Now the law says 54 or 54F, when you purchase, you can purchase it 1 year before the transfer, or you may purchase it 2 years after the transfer, or construct it 3 years after the transfer. For construction, you cannot construct it 1 year before the transfer. So if you have started construction before the transfer, that is fine. The construction should complete within 3 years from the date of transfer. It should not complete prior to the date of transfer of your asset. If it is completed prior to the date of transfer, you will not get the deduction. So you may purchase it 1 year before or 2 years after, but you cannot construct it before the transfer of property. This is an important concept, and there are authorities to support this concept. Now you may make a new residential house, or you may buy it in some colony which is not yet legal, or your new house map is not approved by municipal corporation or TNCP. It may not be legally approved new house, but one thing is sure, that it is a new house constructed by you. So ideally we should ensure all the legalities. But even if it is a not legal house, you are constructing a new house without complying to some conditions of municipal corporation, which in many cases may happen that your house may not comply with all the completion certificates, there is a possibility that income tax would not deny you deduction, because income tax act clearly says that the requirement is construction of new house. There is no express condition that such house may be approved by the municipal corporation or other regulatory authorities as prescribed. It may happen that you have made a transfer of a property and the proceeds have been invested somewhere else, and then you are getting a good deal sometime after. You don't want to disturb those investments. You may take a loan and invest in the new house from such loan amount. In those cases, you may be entitled to the deduction, because the source of investment is not that relevant. As held in various decisions, it is held that even from loan funds, if you buy a new house, you will be entitled to deduction. But if you use the proceeds of sale in repayment of a loan taken for purchase of house property, say 2 years back, you will not get the deduction for repayment of loan or taken for purchase of a residential property. So you can use the loan proceeds in reinvestment, but you may not get deduction for repayment of loan from the original proceeds. Then what happens if you purchase a property in the name of your wife or children? There may be two type of cases. You purchase it jointly in your name and your relative name, or exclusively in the name of your relative. What is important here is the purchase, not ownership. The purchase consideration should be given by me, that is relevant. Name in the owner, name of owner is not that relevant. There are decisions to this effect where either it is purchased in only in the name of relative, reduction is allowed. Even if it is jointly purchased in my name and my relative name, the reduction is allowed. However, we may also note some decisions which are against and which have given a very narrow interpretation to the term assessee and say that the new property must be only in the name of assessee, not in any other way. So both these things may be noted. Whether 54EC, which allows you to purchase bonds, may be allowed in case of purchase, in case of when the transfer is done of depreciable asset. Section 50 deems transfer of depreciable assets to be short-term capital gains. Now, interestingly, it only deems the capital gains as short-term capital gain. It does not deem the asset to be short-term capital asset. The asset will still continue to be long-term capital asset. And 54EC says then when you have transferred a long-term capital asset, you will be entitled to the deduction under 54EC. So here the decision of Ace Builders, Bombay High Court, is very important, which allows you to invest the sale consideration of even of depreciable property in 54EC, and you will be allowed the deduction under such provision. Then, when should be the investment or construction be done? See, prima facie, when you sell a property, the proceeds either have to be invested in the new property before the due date of filing of return. If it is not done, you have to invest it in the capital gain account scheme before the due date. If a assessee comes to you after the due date has expired, by say March, when you can file a belated return, you may advise him that, okay, you had to invest it in capital gain account scheme by say July, but nevertheless, now you cannot invest in capital gain account scheme, but you can still buy the new property by the end of period 139.4. And in those cases, you may be allowed the deduction because the language used says that the investment has to be done by the due date of filing return under section 139, and 139 includes 139.1 as well as 139.4. So even if you invest in the new property by say 31st March, that is the last date of the assessment year till which you can file a belated return, you will be entitled to the deduction under section 54 to 54F of the Act. Then you are filing a return of income, and in those cases, in case of stamp duty value, you are again putting actual consideration. So can AO give you 143.1 notice to make adjustment? Prima facie, he cannot. But if he does, then you may file an appeal against it, as that is the proper manner of litigating such cases. Similarly, there may cases when you are giving the actual consideration as against the stamp duty value, and the AO wants to make addition, you should take an objection that you do not agree to the value, and AO should refer it to the DBO for actual valuation. Even if you do not ask, there is a Calcutta High Court decision which says that if you have shown your actual consideration as your stamp duty value, as your fair value of the asset, then he is obliged to refer it to the district department valuation officer. Then there is a decision, may not be that relevant in income tax, because there is a decision of will tax. 50C applies to land or building. Whether a building under construction is also building, a building under construction under will tax has not been considered as a building. But I am doubtful as to how much this may be applicable in income tax scenario, and even a building under construction may be regarded as a building for 50C. But where an assessee is under litigation, you may take definitely this argument, and at least this would save you penalties in such cases. Then moving ahead from section 50C to 54F, you have a property which you have sold for 10 lakhs. the guideline value may be 15 lakh rupees. Now, the guideline value is higher, 15 lakh rupees, but you are reinvesting whole 10 lakh rupees in 54F. So what would happen in such cases? In such cases, there are some decisions, both in favor and against, which held that in those cases, Section 50C is applicable when you have to compute the deduction. But there may be cases where the net consideration is totally invested in new property, then you may not go to 50C. If the net consideration is invested, there are decisions like Gyanchand Batra, Dhanveer Singh Gambhir, and others which I have cited in favor. There are some decisions also in against. So a caution may be taken before finally deciding what to do. One may also remember some amendments in Section 54. This year, from assessment year 2021, they have given option that once in the lifetime of an assessee, he may buy two residential houses. If the capital gains do not exceed 2 crore rupees, you can purchase or construct two new residential houses instead of one which was originally provided. This option is once in a lifetime. Then 54EC, where investments were made from assessment year 18-19, the investment time which was earlier 3 years is now 5 years for investment in NHAI and REC bonds. So these principles, this is a major change which make it less lucrative, because the investment time of 5 years is much more and may not be that beneficial considering the time cost of money for the assessee, because the investment return in case of such bonds is considerably less. So friends, these were some critical issues in capital gains which I discussed with you all. Before ending the presentation, I would like to just give a disclaimer that all the issues which he has discussed and the advice which is given should be properly researched before applying it to any case, because situations, case laws, everything depends from case to case, and due legal caution and advisory must be adopted before implementing or taking course to any action. These are just food for thought for all of you, and depending on case to case, you may apply all these propositions in the cases wherever you deem it fit. All these were my personal opinions based on the case laws and the legal research which I have done. At the end, I would like to thank the forum for providing me opportunity to give a deliberation on critical issues in capital gains. Question and answers are invited. Thank you very much for such a patient hearing.
Yes, Pankaj sir.
The question is, DBO has not submitted his valuation till 31st 12, and then AO has passed order. Subsequently, what happens? This is not 154, cannot be done in such cases. Why? Because there was no document on record. That report was not on record, and it has to be contested in appeal, based on which there will be a remand report, and then again the issue will be discussed. Next question is, capital gains in case of sale of industrial plot where construction has not taken place. If it is a freehold land, then 50C would definitely apply. 45(3) also applicable to depreciable assets like computer and furniture and fixture. Definitely 45(3) applies to any capital asset, would include these kind of assets. How to do computation of capital gains on the property which is gone for redevelopment? It would depend whether it is pre-45(5A or post-45(5A. If there is a registered agreement post-45(5A, there is a separate code for joint development agreements which provides for the computation mechanism. I'll be sharing my presentation with the forum, which can be circulated with every participant here. Yes, now there is a restriction that the investment has to be made in India only. Earlier, there was a decision of Prema Pisha, which held that the new house may be purchased abroad, which has now been overruled by the amendment in the act, which says the new house has to be in India. With regard to the 10% band in 50C, shall it apply retrospectively? Yes, it will apply retrospectively, and there are decisions to this effect which can be submitted to the officer during the assessment proceedings. If a commercial premise is sold on which depreciation is not claimed, can LTCG be adjusted against block of asset concept? If the asset is included in the block, depreciation may or may not have been claimed during the year, but once it forms a part of block, then it is the block as a whole. It has to be reduced from the block itself, and it loses its identity once it has formed part of the block. So there are cases when in the block a new asset is purchased and the sale consideration of the old asset is much, much more than the value of block. In such case, total block may cease to exist and no depreciation may have been claimed on the new asset also. If the land is owned by partners and building was constructed by the firm, sale consideration was combined, when and how to bifurcate the consideration? See, when the land is owned by partner and building is constructed by the firm, it would depend on the agreement through which the property was combined, because you need to combine. Either the partners may lease the land to the firm, or they contribute the land to the firm, and then it would depend on the situations. Court has passed order in compulsory acquisition that rent to be paid in case of delayed period along with interest. What will be the fate of rent? Whether if it is a rent on house property, it will definitely be charged under the income from house property. There are a lot of pagadi properties where owner may be different, but capital gain may be earned by a different person. Since the owner of land may be different, but you being a tenant, you have a tenancy right in that property, which is also a capital asset, which will give rise to the capital gains. If the construction is started before transfer by taking loan and loan is repaid through the amount of sale consideration, it would depend if the construction gets completed after period, then you need to establish that this was amount is spent on the construction. It may be possible that the amount may be sourced through loan which is repaid, that is allowed. The construction must complete after the transfer within the period of next 3 years. You may use the proceeds to repay the loan which has been used in the construction, that is fine, but the new investment should be done after the period. The total the property construction should complete after the date of transfer. Right, I think there are no major questions left. Thank you very much for such a patient hearing.
Thank you, Pankaj sir. It's our pleasure to listen from you. Wonderful presentation, sir. I already got feedback on my WhatsApp, and also we run a poll here. We got 90%. 90% is a wonderful comment. So an extremely satisfied rating. So it's wonderful session for us, sir. Thank you for giving your time and sharing your experience Thank you once again, sir. We will share PPT thank with you. All the participants. Sir. Thank you all. We are ending the webinar now.
Thank you.